So first of all, I'm very pleased today as editor of the Frontiers Policy Lab to welcome Georg Schütte, who is the former German State Secretary for Research and Education and today the Secretary General of the largest not-for-profit foundation for research in the world, the Volkswagen Stiftung.
Jean-Claude, it's a pleasure to talk to you. I've been working in science and research sponsorship for more than 25 years. In the past, amongst others, I was CEO of a Bonn-based foundation, the Alexander von Humboldt Foundation. And as of the beginning of last year, I have been Secretary General of the Volkswagen Foundation. The Volkswagen Foundation is not really related to the company. We are not a company foundation. Rather, when Volkswagen was privatized in the early 1960s, the revenues of the privatization went into an endowment. And this endowment and the revenues from the endowment now are being used to sponsor science and scholarship in Germany and beyond. That's our mandate. And this is what we try to do at the Volkswagen Foundation. Prior to my current position at the Volkswagen Foundation, for 10 years, I was a state secretary in charge of science and research sponsorship on a ministerial level in Germany, and at the same time also responsible for international relations and European research policy.
You played a very important role in de-blocking open science policies at the European Commission. You probably don't realize it, but you and your colleague Sander Dekker from the Netherlands, who in 2017 published the non-paper on fair open access and data, when it was published and used in the program committees of the European Commission, where I was then in charge of the open science policies, that document, when it was released, was the tipping point for the political resistance against open science to stop and to engage with the Commission in a much more proactive open science, open access, open data policy. If you look back now, so 4 years later, and now that we have that the way the science system has reacted to COVID clearly demonstrates the value of open science and open access. Are you happy with as a former, not only as a former minister, but as a responsible academic and a responsible manager, are you happy with the way the whole dossier of open science, open access and so forth has been evolved? Is it going far enough? Do you see areas where we could still do more? What's your view on this?
Well, we should do more and we have to do more. The question is whether the glass is half full or half empty. I'd rather take the half full approach because different disciplines are prepared in a better or worse sense in terms of use and reuse of data. With regard to COVID and COVID and virus research, I think the scientific and scholarly community got together and opened the files. So when the virus was sequenced, the data became open and accessible almost immediately. So this shows that if needed, the scientific community can react and be a best practice example on how to make data available. But if I look, for example, at the German context, within the community of scholars of the economy and society, there is a debate about public data on the economy and public societal data, and a plea to make these data accessible to the scholarly community. So there is definitely room for improvement if we look not only at academic data in the academic realm, but also data which are available within governments, within public agencies. These data can be used, need to be used, and need to be used in a context of liberal, open, democratic societies. By that, we can also set an example if we look at international collaboration and international competition. One of the European mantras in terms of technology and innovation policy was and is, let's be competitive if we look both to the United States and to Asia and China as a major player. But we not only have to be competitive on a technological level, we also need to be competitive in terms of how we organize our societies, how we organize and self-organize our political systems. This is also a question of competitiveness. And if we bring the two together, technology and open societies, this can set a standard and an example as well. So we need to do more. Data are out there. They have to be standardized. They have to be accessible. They have to be usable and reusable. And we need to continue to work on it.
I must say, I quite like this viewpoint, because I never heard it, so that you actually see the philosophy of open science as a cornerstone of what a modern Western European open society is and should be, the values we stand for. And I think that's I personally think that's a more interesting way than, well, or it's an interesting way to fill in the concept of digital sovereignty, because it might quickly become a digital closure. Whereas the way you define it, it's being sovereign in defining how we want to be open and set the standard. So that's a quite nice way of looking at it. If we go now to your role at the Volkswagen Stiftung, so you took up the job when the virus started, so you became in charge of a very large foundation in the middle of a very large crisis. How has this affected the philosophy, the policies of the Stiftung? And in general, your view on what foundations can do?
What can foundations do as compared to the public research sponsoring sector? We can be faster, number one. We can be more open and we can be more risk-oriented. At the same time, foundations have the privilege to take a more long-term view. While politics is and policy in general is challenged to provide immediate answers and immediate relief in this crisis situation, we as foundations can also, and as a foundation, can take a longer view and look at the science and research system and see how this changes. And here we have to be aware that while we see a huge investment into virus research now, we also need to be prepared for a future that might challenge us in completely different ways. And to address this and to create an awareness for this is also necessary. The bottom line is foundations operate in a responsibility towards society. We benefit from a tax privilege. We have the autonomy to decide within a certain legal context about the way we want, where and how to spend our money, but we need to justify, to legitimize it towards society. And this is our core obligation, certainly.
The sub-team of the policy labs for which this interview runs is changing the world with science. So you're actually also already thinking now, what are the big changes due to Corona? Because it's clear that we will not go back to the world as it was in 2019. Fundamental things are changing. And you see your role as foundation also to support the research to rethink and remodel what will come once we will be allowed to live normally.
Am I correct? Definitely. And one needs this long-term view. If you look at vaccine development, the BioNTech vaccine based on messenger RNA, the idea came out of universities in the mid late 1970s, was then explored in the context of cancer research and cancer therapeutics, and eventually and on a rather short-term basis was then applied to vaccine development for a SARS-CoV-2 virus. So we need a longer term perspective to be prepared, and foundations can be a breeding ground for new ideas. We can be the ones who go the unbeaten path, who explore new ones. What we need to do is, and what foundations can do is, beyond the immediate focus in a crisis, broaden up the way of thinking, the perspective, and look at on the one hand, midterm challenges, in this case, treatment development, and long-term challenges. And here we even have to be broader. Let's not only look at infectious diseases and pandemics. The next crisis can come from anywhere else. It can be related to cybersecurity. If some of our critical infrastructures are being hampered on a European level, electricity distribution, water distribution, a catastrophe. Let's look at the risk of nuclear research. Let's look at the ramifications of climate change. So we have to look broader and have to explore other causes that might pose challenges to our societies.
No, because no, this is great to hear, because we can't afford to stop the world again for another year. The key problem to be very efficient in what you were just saying is twofold. On the one hand, having the right science, but you are working on that. But on the other hand, having the right ways to inject that science in the policy.
Right.
You have been in the middle of it. I have been on the other side of it. But I saw that as one of the key frustrations is, how can we bridge these two worlds in a way that is more efficient, more anticipatory, which allows us to be better prepared for whatever that comes?
Well, what we see during this COVID crisis, at least in Germany, is a much closer interaction between the scientific community and the political realm. And not only in Germany, we see that in other European countries as well, and on the EU level also. And it's a learning experience, definitely, because it is not only a bilateral interaction that takes place. It takes place in a context that is open to the public. If we look at the German example, in early summer of 2020, opinion polls indicated that the trust into science and scientific advice had risen to more than two-thirds of those who responded in the polls. Orientation towards science and science advice, and huge trust into the content of the advice. It has gone down slowly. This is just one indicator that in times of crisis of this nature, society looks at science and asks for advice. There is, on the demand side, a huge demand for scientific information. But as you said, it has to be understandable. And who are the conduits of scientific information? Well, we always think in terms of traditional, my generation, mid-50s, things in terms of traditional media, television, radio, the print media. If we look at print media in Germany, they are in a financial crisis. They can no longer afford to hold and to employ huge staffs of journalists. So what did they do? They cut down the scientific beats. And who covered the pandemic? It was the journalists who work on the political beat. How do they do this? They ask scientists A and scientists B. And if they have a controversy, this is the best they could ask for, because then it's bipartisan and they can find a middle way. No matter whether this one opinion is a 90% right or 10% right, or supported by scientific advice opinion. What I want to say by mentioning this example, the expertise on the political beat on how to get proper information from within the science system, how to put this into context, how to evaluate the information and then ask the right people, it was not there. And so we need to support reporting about science, and we need new intermediaries to support traditional media to get a proper sense of what's out there in science and research. So we have in Germany, for example, a science media center supported by public foundations, and they try to collect information from within science and make it available to traditional media. But we also look and need to look at the new media outlets. We have to look at social media, at online media. This is the present. This is the future.
When I was working in the commission and in my little field, I could see that, and you probably as a state secretary as well, there are thousands of reports and hundreds of thousands of articles. The point is not the knowledge. The point is the communication of the knowledge. And too much of the old science communication paradigm is, okay, I take a complicated report and I rewrite it simple. But that doesn't work. That doesn't work because then you lose the essence, the hard evidence, you know. So I completely support what you say there, that we should reinvent science communication and adapt it to the new channels which we have.
That's right. And it's not only about scientific results. It's also about the process of science. This we learned during the past year, that we have to explain how scientific knowledge comes into being, how it is being created, and what the meaning of scientific truth is. This is not eternal truth. It's the best of knowledge that is available, which needs to be challenged within the scholarly and scientific community, which needs to be questioned. So short-term perspectives on this process are mistaken if the interpretation goes like there is a scientific truth and we cannot trust it because it's being challenged. It's natural that it is being challenged. So the explanation and interpretation of knowledge creation within the scientific system, this needs to be made understood. And that also is a challenge. And we have to be careful if we look at the interface between science and politics and the public at large. Scientific advice is, especially in this time of a crisis, it is advice. It's not policy prescription. There is no blueprint that can be political blueprint that can be derived from scientific knowledge, which needs to be transient, which needs to be challenged. So there is a difference, and a scientification of the political process needs to be prevented in a sense that science can prescribe what politics needs to do. No, it's a more complex decision-making process within the political realm. And science can provide options for action, but cannot prescribe clear action.
Georg, as we do with every interviewer, we round up these talks, always with the same two questions, so that we can have a kind of a transversal view on how our experts and privileged speakers react to the same question. So I will do them consequently, and then I will not interfere, so you have the floor for you. The first question: as Secretary General of the Volkswagen Stiftung, what is the most important lesson you have learned since the pandemic with respect to science and policy making, and of course how science and policy making reacted to the pandemic?
Well, it's probably a threefold lesson that I learned. And it's threefold in a way that we need to be prepared, we need to be open, and we need to be curious. What do I mean by this? To be prepared means that private foundations should be able and always be in a position to react immediately to challenges in a way to provide insight, at least in terms of science sponsoring foundations. We need then to enable the scientific system to provide information analysis in order to cope and deal with a crisis. We need to be open in order to come up with ideas and an early warning system for upcoming challenges to society. So we have to explore the horizon. And we need to be curious in a way that we are open for impulses from within the science system. The curiosity of researchers may lead us into new ways of thinking and new realms of perspectives of how we look at future development. And if we apply these three criteria, we should be able to make a difference to, and to contribute to the future of society that is able to deal with challenges that call for, cry for answers from within science and scholarship.
Imagine you would be able to change one thing in how the world of science and of policy reacted to the corona crisis and the development of the vaccine. What is the key game changer you would change so that in the future we would at least tackle a new pandemic with much better equipment, not only technically, but also as human, as a society?
Well, one way to do this is to expose ourselves to unusual perspectives, challenge our traditional ways of thinking by listening to those who have outside opinions, but not maverick outside opinions, but well-founded outside opinions. We need to listen to various perspectives in order to come up with the best and brightest ideas.
Okay, thank you very much, Georg, for this view on the future of science communication, because I sense what you're saying there is that the problem is not the amount of information, but the way, because we have it, we have all these articles, we have all these reports, thousands, millions of them, but the way we communicate them. And you seem to hint that reinventing the modalities of science communication much more towards an interactive, visual way, provocative way of presenting key insights. And that's a little bit what we would try to do with the Frontiers Policy Labs, rather than, you know, dumping long reports and then hoping that it is picked up somewhere by someone for his policy work. So I think this is indeed one of the challenges the short-term challenges of the future, to reinvent science communication. Thank you for that.
Jean-Claude, for me, it was a pleasure, and it's wonderful to exchange ideas like this. And if we have further opportunities to do so, it would be wonderful. Because as I said, we need to learn from each other. We need to take the perspectives of the others to look at what we do ourselves. And exchanges like this are extremely helpful to do so. So for me, it's a learning experience. It's a matter of curiosity and getting new insights. And for this, I really enjoyed our meeting and our conversation. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for your time indeed.